he has started describing Satyavan. And then in 13, what do you see that? Led by the wisdom of an adverse fate.
See, his life has proceeded in a, I mean, life has a twin method.
Yeah.
It's an adverse method also, and it has got a sweet method also.
Sir. But the crucial phrase, crucial adjective is wisdom.
Yes, sir, wisdom.
Of an adverse fate. Yes, wisdom. Means, although
it would be a tragedy.
In the human manner of speaking, it will be adverse fate.
Yes, it will be a tragedy that
it will, exactly.
that tragedy befell.
That is a purposeful tragedy, purposeful, meaningful
purposeful misfortune.
Yes, exactly, sir. That's right. I mean, if you see in the immediate reckoning, then you will feel sorry, unhappy, and that kind of a thing. You
yes,
see, oh, I was a king, I was a prince. Now I'm living in the desert.
Now I'm so sorry. Now I'm so sorry.
That's right. Yeah, exactly. Whereas here, there is a wisdom. Why he has to become a mendicant or a person living in the ashram in the, without the royalty around him and that kind of a thing, you see. There is a wisdom that, you see. So, and at the same time, another word, crucial word, drama. Abandoning man's love drama, he had come.
Yes, sir.
See, man's love drama, he was a prince and he could have been moving in great royalty there with chariots, with soldiers, with weapons, everything all around, that kind of a thing was there. He sort of abandoned that. In fact, he was helpless. But it is the wisdom of that adverse fate which made him do that.
Right. So, there is something very interesting, the whole imagery
yeah.
of this portion.
Yeah.
When one sees in this thing
yeah.
is like Satyavan, we have another crucial phrase is ancient
yeah.
mother, sir, to
yeah,
meet the
exactly.
ancient mother in her groves.
Yeah.
In her groves.
Yeah.
Now the thing is, Satyavan, after having come to the forest,
yeah.
and the way the entire narrative is there,
yeah.
he perceives the entire forest as a temple.
Yeah.
And as the temple of the ancient mother.
Okay, yeah,
and
yeah.
within the temple, he sees these beings and all of them
yeah.
In a certain sacred way.
Yeah.
And so his relationship with this entire environment
uh-huh.
is of an order of a certain kind. So in the same kind of a perspective,
yeah.
he would see the man's loud drama.
Yeah.
And he would not, so that would be on the very peripheral part
in
of
fact,
the temple, outside the temple.
In fact, perhaps he feels happy that loud drama is over and I left it behind
yes,
and I'm
yes,
here
sir.
In the great company of...
I'm here in the temple,
yeah, yeah,
seated
yeah,
right
yeah,
in the divine company.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And there is on the periphery outside, you can hear the sound of the loud drama,
yeah, yeah.
which I mean, you would just listen as a thing to be not... kind of wished for
yeah.
in a way.
Yeah, one need not give much attention to that
yes,
kind
sir.
Of thing.
Yes, sir. Because yeah. it does not, it's not meaningful
yeah.
And it's not purposeful.
That is possible.
For him.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. But here, and of course, in the immediate context, the symbolism is ancient mother. Actually, this word ancient mother, mighty mother, unhappy mother, it appears a number of places in Savitri.
Yes,
ancient mother in the context of the distant meeting place where there is no man living there, but nature alone, trees, flowers, mountains, rivers, animals, birds, that kind of a thing. Mean the primal nature in its purity, undisturbed, unaffected by thought and the makings of mind. It is not that way. So that way, the purity of knowledge which you would get directly from all these creatures and beings and things around has a different value than getting knowledge through the mental faculty.
Right.
A sort of an identity is established with everything around and the tree says, yes, I am here. This is what I can do. This is what my joy is. The trees, they are speaking to him. The birds are speaking to him. The rivers are speaking to him. The mountains are telling him something.
The flowers are speaking to him what mother used to find out. Their own aspiration they are revealing to him.
That's right. Yeah, precisely. They are revealing their own aspiration. That's right. Yeah, that's very true. Yeah.
So that kind of association.
Yes. So he is getting direct knowledge from that ancient mother. The mental faculty is not there, and therefore he is advanced the Vedanta-knower. Vedanta-knower means it's not that he knows the suktas and who composed what, rishis and all that kind of thing.
This is the unwritten book. It also says unwritten book.
That's right, unwritten book, you see, which is there in the divine library.
Yes, sir. Which mind has not really worried too much about.
That's right. Yeah. But unwritten book. You see, obviously, in fact, one could, from a purely mental point of view, one could even argue something like this: if the tale of Savitri belongs not just to the Vedic period, but it could be even to the pre-Vedic period, that what Shivan indicates, no?
Yes, sir.
It might even belong to the pre-Vedic period. If it is pre-Vedic period, then how can this boy be Vedanta-knower?
Right, sir. Right, sir.
You see, because we just...
But Shivananda says that it is belongs to the Vedic cycle.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it could be before as another thing, but he is definitely confirmed the Vedic cycle.
So, therefore he is saying immediately, unwritten book. It is not the Vedas which are classified in this manner, etc. The knowledge source, the spiritual knowledge. Here, Veda would stand for the divine knowledge itself directly, which is written somewhere in our script elsewhere. And he has sort of an access to that knowledge. He can read the script, he can understand that script, he can respond to that script directly.
So, all the symbols which are there in the Veda.
Yeah.
He already sees the realities behind those symbols.
That's right. Yeah, he already sees them.
So he sees Agni, he sees Vayu, he sees...
surely, yeah. All the gods, etc. I mean, he is sort of moving around with them. In fact, he says, no, later on, that he sat in the company of the sages and thought this, thought that, etc. Yes. Later on. So the Veda knower is something... in fact, this is the most important thing. Perusing the mystic scripture of her forms, he had caught her hyphenated significances, her speared immense imaginations, etc., etc. Now, these are not the details which one would find immediately in the Vedas also.
Right.
But because his knowledge is directly, intimately connected with that, he can see that thing. In fact, later on, we have here also, no? He says here, he is a wanderer, 14, he is a wanderer communing with depth and marge.
Right, sir.
Before that, you have a wonderful line here, middle line, heir to the centuries of the lonely wise. He has already possessed from somebody directly. Now, so these are not only the immediate rishis which are there in the ashram, but he had that access to them.
He's communing with them, sir.
Because he was in divine communion with
depth and marge.
You know, with the ancient mother.
Right, sir.
Because of his identity with the ancient mother, she gave him all that Vedic knowledge and all those associations, everything directly, you see. And then, of course, as a human, then he says, his acts were rhythmic with her primal force. That is the great quality of Satyavan. Her primal force of ancient mother.
Right, sir.
They were in tune, in harmony with what she would like him to do, you see. And then, of course, we have got the most wonderful line here. That day, he had turned from his accustomed paths. So, that is the crucial turning point here now. So, the poet, as a kind of an essayist, has first described Savitri seeing sort of a dream figure around here, laying in the background, and then the description of that whole figure is there. This is the entire description of that figure which Savitri is seeing. And now, that figure is becoming concrete. It is emerging in blood and flesh. From this point onward, you see that he is now being described Yes,
But the portions earlier are now we have this description of Satyavan here.
Yeah.
Now we can have two, three possibilities with this.
Yeah.
Either this description is being perceived by Savitri in as the psychic remembrance in her kind of reveals itself.
Yes.
As this is the person I have been
seeing
in all these lives.
Yeah.
Or it could be, we can say, author's notes.
Yeah.
Which he is preparing us for the purposes of the their meeting and all.
Actually, what you are saying is absolutely true. It could be. It is not the author's narrative. It is not just author's narrative. But because Savitri is, you know, this line, first line 8, as might a soul on nature's background limned stand out for a moment in a house of dream. Now, that figure, that soul, standing out in a house of dream.
In her invoking
something has suddenly awakened in her, and now, yes, that whole description follows here.
Right.
So, I mean, it is basically, what you are saying is true, it is basically the continuation still
of Savitri only.
Of the narrative of Savitri. But Savitri is seeing like that.
But in a psychic remembrance.
Well, psychic dream, what this is here.
And this is a thing with Satyavan that even in his earlier this thing, he has had that link to the ancient mother.
Yeah, but then this is what Savitri is seeing.
Right, sir.
Again, this is what Savitri is seeing. You see, I mean, it is not that poet is supplying us the details.
Right, sir.
Poet is rather narrating what is being seen, witnessed, observed by Savitri.
Right.
He is reading the mind of Savitri
right.
and telling us all the details, you see.
Right. So, if, seeing from this,
yeah.
Savitri should have already known that she will not find, I mean, if this revelation had happened earlier,
yeah.
she would have already known that you need not bother wander into the
city. No, well, possibly. But at the same time, she's in, was it a dream? See, I mean, that dream has to become real also.
Right, sir.
So, the other things have to unfold,
right,
you see.
Right, sir.
Because he says very clearly a dream.
Yes, sir.
House of dream.
But he also says, sir, as might a soul.
Yeah, that's all right.
He may be even creating.
But in a house of dream.
Yes, sir.
You see.
So, but this is one of the ways maybe we can evaluate how much this thing one can associate with the dream and with her own perception.
No, because she suddenly sensing, perceiving something. It doesn't have yet that full concreteness, that full reality.
Right, sir.
You see, in that sense.
Right, sir.
And in her dream, in that house of dream, she is seeing the whole picture of Satyavan in this manner. That he is the spirit of God, he is Vedanovar, all those things, she is seeing all that thing. So, it did not necessarily mean that this is the description of the physical Satyavan which the poet is presenting to us at the moment,
right,
you see.
Right, sir.
But rather, what is going on in the soul of Savitri, in the psychic memory or whatever you call it, in Savitri, it is that which is being presented. Yeah.
Right, sir.
That is very true. In fact, that is a greater insight, I will say. It's very good. Yeah. Yeah.
Whereas this line said that day he had turned from his accustomed.
Now from your point, this point onward, the reality, because Savitri is in search, she's physically doing.
Yes,
now the other physical action has to come
right,
here.
Sir.
You see.
Right. So now it goes back to
yes,
the
physical, to the storyline,
physical narrative, sir.
Yeah, yes, to the storyline. Yeah, that's right.
So till 17, it is her. That,
that's right. Yeah.
House of dreams, sir. In a way,
he has introduced to us in a certain manner, directly, indirectly, in whatever way you want to call it. As a person there, and now the presentation of the person follows
right,
it. Actually, this line is coming to the storyline. That day, he turned from his accustomed paths. So, naturally, this is a group of hermitages. One day he would go like this, the next day he would go like this, third day he might go like this, fourth day like that. Different ways for whatever purposes it might be there, depending upon the season.
Now there is one more line, sir, which comes there about this particular spot.
Yeah.
In the same sentence,
yeah.
It's this phrase, flowering verge.
Yes. Yeah.
So this particular day, I mean, on this day where
yeah.
love is to meet him also,
yeah.
he has actually gone on the verge of the flowers, where
yes.
flowers are this
yes.
aspiration of
yeah. drawn into the forest flowering verge.
Verge.
That's right.
Yes,
yeah, means psychologically he is telling the reader, well, something happy, beautiful, joyous is going to happen there, something to flower out, open out, you see, blossom out, you see. Yeah.
The flowers aspiration and all
yeah.
at the base
yeah.
is about that divine love which has plunged into earth.
Yeah,
they are manifestation and expression
yeah.
of
well, that is the expression of love, that is true. But
yes,
also
sir.
Flower, the symbol of beauty, happiness, expression of love,
right,
joy,
sir.
You see.
Right, sir.
Spontaneity.
So the spell of destiny, spell of destiny on his feet,
yeah.
Naturally brought him to that thing, because destiny was
yeah.
Kind of directing him
yes,
to
right.
meet
yeah.
the
yeah.
love today.
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
In that sense,
that is very true. But basically, that destiny is all the while active also.
Right, sir.
See, I mean, at that particular moment of time, Savitri should come here. Satyavan should come here, and
right,
they sort of encounter, meet each other, and all that thing. See, in physics, what you would call the area of interaction, the cross section of interaction,
right, sir,
is extremely small. It has to happen exactly at a precise moment, at a precise time.
Sir.
Had she gone 10 minutes earlier,
the two circles touching each other at
yeah.
just one point,
yeah,
and
important.
Their movement
so
has
the,
to be such.
The cross section of interaction is very small. See.
Exactly, sir.
Is very
especially
small.
In this case when she was
but, yeah.
wanting to move towards the paths where people are, where there's a society, and
yeah,
so
that's right. Yeah.
Obviously, it was a very small point of interaction,
yes,
in
yeah,
intersection.
Yeah, yeah.
Because of that.
And so therefore, this is the important thing.
Yes, sir.
Therefore, destiny.
Yes, sir.
The element of destiny immediately. Destiny will say, although there is a small cross section, I must catch it. I must be there in time.
Right, sir.
Otherwise, the whole thing will be spoiled.
Right,
had he woken up 10 minutes late,
it would have.
Or her horse refused to run
yes.
with proper speed.
Right, sir. The bus would have left the station.
Yes, right.
Yes, so there is another this thing, if you see.
Which one?
We have her mind at first dwelt in ideal dreams.
26, that's right.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
this also indicates in a way
yeah.
of this whole ideal dreams which she was, her psychic remembrance
yeah.
was
yeah.
indulging in
yeah.
prior to that whole God touching in time and informing her to how
yeah.
to react and all.
Yeah. Yeah, well, that is true. But here, it's true. But you see, he say her mind at first dwelt in ideal dream. She, this ideal dream for of what? See, before that you have other things, you see, before that line, a look, a turn decides our ill-poised fate.
Right,
22.
Sir. Right, sir. It's very interesting, sir, a look or turn decides our ill-poised fate.
Huh.
Only to indicate, sir, that most of the times we are not, I mean, there are so many moments
yeah.
where we are not alert at all.
Yeah.
And that is where the destiny really takes over.
Yeah.
And it even uses a very small window of opportunity to play its role in determining the outcomes of our life.
That is true, yeah. Yeah. See, yeah, here you got no.
Here see, is the physical thing which starts, sir. From
yeah,
her,
in a way, yeah.
Thing.
See, you got next sentence. Thus, in the hour that most concerned
her
all.
All. Now, this could be that hour also, sir. Again, as you were
yes.
you were saying,
early
the
morning,
other, early morning this thing, day of fate,
yes.
this could also could apply
hour.
To that
yeah,
hour
yeah.
also, sir.
Yeah.
Because that
thus
hour.
In the hour that most concerned her, all.
Right, sir.
Now, of course, this is the element of poet's commentary.
Right, sir.
This line is a kind of a poet's comedy. He
right.
is reading her mind and is telling her that thing. Wandering and worn but slow, etc. To wake her body spirit to its king. That's the most crucial thing.
Yes,
this
body
most
spirit
crucial.
To its king.
See, that hour, the concern of that hour is what? What is the concern of that hour? That her body
wakes to
should
its
wake to its king. So, the poet is also telling her, that the meeting of Satyavan and Savitri is not just love's meeting of two young people coming together and falling into love. It's not just that, but Savitri's physical transformation possibility opens out only with that meeting.
Right, sir.
With that meeting.
Right, sir. Because it's her cells will wake up to their Lord kind of a thing.
Yeah,
sir.
The body, the process of physical transformation begins only when love is discovered.
That's it. And it's incidentally, sir, this canto is a very, among the many cantos, it's very few which has got the theme of transformation in such a large measure.
Yes.
It's either the, let's say, 11th book which has a which has that theme in a big way. And this is one of them, sir. It's got couple of almost two pages.
Yes, that's right. Therefore, this phrase is important.
Yes, sir.
Her body is waking.
Yes, sir.
To its Lord. It is not the physical union of a boy and a girl. It is not that. The body is waking. It means that it is really opening to the possibilities of the spirit which can enter into it, you see.
Right.